Good morning. Welcome to worship. Happy Father's Day. It's a good day to give thanks for the fathers and the father figures in our lives and, of course, for our Father in heaven. Not a lot of announcements today. This is Father's Day. Wednesdays, we're still having Bible fellowship. We're about to move on to something new. I'm not yet sure exactly what that's going to be. If you want to know, just turn up and be surprised. And Sundays, of course, now we're having our breakfast club again. And already we're here. 4th of July is practically on top of us. It's just coming up on Saturday. And then July 5th is our Independence Day weekend. And, you know, heads up, Georgine's a little under the weather, so we'll be using recorded music today. And I will be coordinating that from here. And since Matt and Michelle are at a family reunion, I will be, if there's bumps, there might be a bump. I'm juggling a lot of balls today, but this is going to be kind of exciting, so I'm looking forward to it, and I hope you are too. And even though, you know, there's nobody at the piano, we're going to hear a prelude. So I encourage you to prepare your hearts and minds for worship as we listen to it together. Let's go in. Here we go. Our opening hymn is Rise Up, Ye Saints of God. We're going to be singing all four verses, if you could stand together as we sing.
Oops. Rise up, ye saints of God, the kingdom tarries long. Rise up, ye saints of God, the church for you doth wait, her strength unequal to her task. Rise up and make her great. Lift high the cross of Christ, tread where his feet have trod. As brothers of the Son of Man, rise up, ye saints of God.
Had to cut that short. There's no way to go back. If you noticed, I accidentally advanced it past the first hymn. So like I said, there might be a glitch or two. Would you join me in our call to worship from Psalm 6? Be gracious to me, O Lord, for I am languishing. Turn, O Lord, save my life. Deliver me for the sake of your steadfast love. I am weary with my moaning. Every night I flood my bed with tears. I drench my couch with my weeping. Depart from me, all you workers of evil, for the Lord has heard the sound of my weeping.
The Lord has heard my supplication. The Lord accepts my prayer.
turn. O Lord, save my life. Deliver me for the sake of your steadfast love. All my enemies shall be ashamed and struck with terror. I always like this hymn. You notice when David's faced by all his enemies, he's not like in a rage. He's not saying, make my sword sharp. Look at how he is. He's just grieved over the whole situation. Our hymn of praise this morning is Stand By Me. Tune's a little different on this one, but it's close enough. We're going to be able to nail it. We are going to sing all four verses of this.
Storms of life are raging, stand by me. When the storms of life are raging, stand by me. When the world is tossing me like a ship upon the sea, thou who rulest wind and water, stand by me. In the midst of tribulation, stand by me. In the midst of tribulation, stand by me. When the host of hell assail and my strength begins to fail, thou who never lost a battle, stand by me. In the midst of faults and failures, stand by me. In the midst of faults and failures, stand by me. When I've done the best I can, and my friends misunderstand, thou who knowest all about me, stand by me. In the midst of persecution, stand by me. In the midst of persecution, stand by me. When my foes in war array undertake to stop my way, thou who saved Paul and Silas, stand by me.
Thank you. You may be seated. Now that is the old-time tempo that just takes your breath away. I ask now if we have any prayers or joys or concerns that you have that you'd like to share now so that we might take them before God together in prayer. Yeah, Robert. Other concerns or joys this morning?
Sharon, y'all pray for my granddaughter. She broke her little toe.
Oh, poor thing. She's never going to wear that boot or stay still. It's going
to
be...
I think they're going to have to do surgery.
Is it the one inside the foot? Or it's...
Yes, the little toe.
Any other joys or concerns this morning? Let us go before the Lord in prayer. Most gracious God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we come before you today to give you thanks for the gift of your Son and your Spirit, through whom and by which we become members of your family, sons and daughters of our Most High God. And we also thank you for, on this day, the men in our life who have given us guidance, who have been actual or figurative fathers to us. We do come before you with the confidence of children, knowing that we can trust you with our cares and worries. We ask you, especially this morning, to watch over our brother Paul as he travels to Kansas, that you would give his spirit strength to be with him, and that they would know your love for them and for one another. We ask that you would alleviate his brother's suffering, And that we also ask, Lord, that you would be with a little girl who broke her toe. From the beginning of our life to the end, there are things that we cannot fix. And we ask that you would teach all of us always to look to you, our Father in heaven, who cares for us. Because we're an easily distracted people. And we think we don't have the time, or we can't pay the attention, or won't show the patience for you. We persist in seeing the world through our own conflicting desires, which truly are blind guides, full of worry and fear, or complacency and pride. And so we miss out on everything. The joy of life in your presence, the comfort of Christian fellowship, the blessing of being able to bless others with the good news we ourselves have received. Please, Father, let the Holy Spirit fill your people this morning. Keep us steadfast in your word. Protect and comfort us in our temptations. Defend us against all enemies, and bring your peace to your church through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, and who also taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our hymn of preparation this morning is His Eye is on the Sparrow. It's also number 2146 in the Faith We Sing. And I invite you to stand as we sing it together. We'll be singing all three verses.
Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Let not your heart be troubled. His tender word I hear, and resting on his goodness, I lose my doubts and fears. Though by the path he leadeth, but one step I may see. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Whenever I am tempted, whenever clouds arise, when song gives place to sighing, when hope within me dies. I draw the closer to him, but one step I may see. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me.
You may be seated.
Will you join me for the prayer of illumination? O Lord, your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light to our path. Give us grace to receive your truth in faith and love, and strength to follow on the path you set before us. Through Jesus Christ. Amen. The gospel reading is Matthew 10, 24 through 39. A disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher, and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I will also have acknowledged before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before the others, I will also deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Three boys were bragging about their fathers to one another. The first boy said, "My father is so fast, he can shoot an arrow at a bullseye and catch it before it gets there." The second boy says, "My dad can shoot a bullet at a deer and catch the deer and hogtie it before the bullet gets there." And the third boy said, "That's pretty impressive, but I think my father might be faster than both of yours. He gets off work at 4:30, but he's always home by 4:15. I like that because, you know, there's sort of that naive trust and just belief in anything. And of course, I laugh partially because I know the day comes when they're no longer looking up and they begin to see eye to eye. And they come to a knowledge that their fathers are flawed and struggling human beings just like them. But, you know, in the year 2000, there was a book that was written. It was called Father Need by Kyle Pruitt. And he pointed out at the time that as far as for all of our knowledge of child development, the relationship between infants and fathers was still, in fact, in its infancy. And he pointed to an article by Vicki Ferris at the University of Connecticut, who showed that in scientific reports about the influence of family relationships on children and their behavior, the father is not even mentioned in half of them. However, in the 25% where they did bother to take a look at the father, they always found something interesting and important to understand. So that all those expert parenting books that they got had this horrible blind spot when it came to the role and importance of fathers. And at this point, most people are familiar with the statistics, and some of them are quite striking. I'll give you three. It turns out that 90% of runaway and homeless children come from households where there's no father. That's 32 times the average. 85% of children who have behavior disorders also come from households without fathers. That's 20 times the average. As for daughters, if they come from a single-parent household without a father, there are 7 times more likely to have children as teenagers and nearly twice as likely to get a divorce themselves. So we look at these statistics, and I wonder what must the cost then be if this is the cost of having no earthly father. What must be the cost and the effect of not having a heavenly father, of growing up in a world where God is a concept and not a loving and a living presence? Jesus himself was bringing this message to what was perhaps the most religious phase ever in Israel. Everyone knew the law. They would go to the synagogue weekly and hear it read. They discussed it. They argued it in the streets, the way we would argue politics or talk about sports. This is what they did. It was their life. And yet, when he describes them, he says, "What shall I liken this generation to? It's like children sitting in the marketplace, calling out to each other. We played the pipe for you, and you wouldn't dance. We wailed, and you wouldn't mourn. Today, we might add a few more. We protested, and you would not raise your voice with ours. We posted on Facebook, you would not like it. We put up a video channel, and you wouldn't subscribe." Children in the marketplace, calling out to one another to play their games. And what strikes me about that image is that they're all children. They're not doing anything wrong. It's not a criticism of them, but they ought to be, if he's talking about the men and women of his generation, grown-ups. But that currently they're so immature and stuck in their own games, they can't even see the actual business of life, of what's going on. The kingdom is walking in their midst, and if they're not careful, it might just pass them by. Of course, when I look at the confusion in the world and people wandering around, I always like to remind myself of Hebrews 11:6, where it says, "Without faith, it's impossible to please God, for all who would approach him must first believe that God exists and reward those who seek him." So people who are really earnestly trying to seek God, they're not using God as an excuse for one thing or another, they won't come away empty-handed. But ultimately, we know that it's through Jesus Christ that our Heavenly Father is made known to us. It's through Jesus Christ that we become children of the Father, not just metaphorically, which is true generally. God's creator, he's father of the earth, he's father of the air, he's father of the stars, he's father of all human beings. But in Christ, it is more than a metaphor. It becomes relational. We enter into the same relationship he has with his father. And it's more than that. It's spiritual. And the spirit is more real, although it doesn't occur to us, than everything that we see. And the life that Jesus is talking about at the end of that passage, even if we save it, if we get the life we want, we're going to lose it. It goes with the body, but the life that lasts forever, we receive from God, from our Heavenly Father. The Father decrees it, the Son accomplishes it, the Holy Spirit puts it into effect. That's the basic theological summary of the gospel, of how it is that we have God as our Father. So despite the fact that, you know, God is mentioned several times in this passage as Father, How does that relate to fatherhood? Well, apart from knowing God as Father, for those who live in a fatherless universe, they're just thrown into the world. It's a place of confusion. They're left to their own devices to sort of carve out their space in the world or to make sense of the mess, or perhaps they can receive from their own parents some cultural values, some position or understanding. But as the existential philosophers would say, we just feel like we're thrown into a mess. We don't know where it came from and we don't know where it's going. But in this passage, Jesus has finished teaching his disciples and he's about to send them out. Just as it says clearly in the Gospel of John, just as the Father sent me, I am sending you. So that we're no longer thrown into the world, but we are sent by God our Father, and we're sent with a mission to make known the kingdom of God, to proclaim the good news, to make sure that others are not continuing to wander in a world without a father. Imagine growing up in a fatherless world. All the ways that we understand the world that are taught to us, if we go to school or we go to college, if you're looking at anthropology, if you're looking at sociology, if you're looking at history, if you're looking at political science, it doesn't matter. You won't find God mentioned except as a source of conflict or a set of human beliefs. He's not the father of the world. The world, its nations, its leaders grew up fatherless in a fatherless universe, and therefore they are very, very troubled children, playing unsupervised in the marketplace. But Jesus has come and found us in this faraway world into which we found ourselves as though thrown. I think sometimes of the parable of the prodigal son. Jesus is saying something different there, but imagine if the older brother hadn't been a stick in the mud and just very unforgiving and angry towards his younger son, and the father had said to him, go and find your brother. He's lost himself in the midst of his troubles. He's beaten down and he's forgotten where he belongs and who he is. And that older son had gone into that far country and found his younger brother or younger sister and helped them remember who they were and put on their hands a signet ring and told them that they're sent too to go find their other brothers and sisters and to give the message and to remind them they have another home and another place to be. And one day he will come and bring us home. I like the way Jesus uses a transition here. He tells us not to be afraid three times, but it's not the same. It follows a progression. At first, it's don't be afraid of them. Don't be afraid of the truth. Eventually, it's all going to become known. It will become apparent who was the truth teller and who was the liar. Don't be afraid of them. Then he moves on. Because those who live in fear, it's a hard habit to break. He says, don't fear them. Fear the one who is able to not just kill your body, but destroy your soul in hell too. And some people just stop cold at that passage. It sends a chill down their spine. They don't bother to keep reading. Where he says, are not two sparrows sold for a penny, and yet not one will fall to the ground apart from your father? Do they hear the word father? If they hear it, if they know it, if their spirit cries out, father, then the last do not be afraid, for you are of more value than many sparrows. That is the progression of the Christian faith, the perfection of the love of God that casts out that fear once and for all. We no longer know God as judge, but we know God as our loving Father who will not see anything less than the very best for us. He's pretty direct, too. I noticed that the language, he says, not a sparrow falls apart from your father. He doesn't say a sparrow doesn't build a nest apart from your father, or a sparrow doesn't take out a second mortgage on its nest. He says falls. He's being honest with them. You know, the world can be a rough place, and you don't necessarily know what's coming or what God has in mind. But even if, from the standpoint of the world, it appears that God doesn't catch you when you fall, You're always in your Father's hands. He knows everything. He knows the very number of hairs on your head. Once you're safe in your Father's hands, you're safe forever. The ancient commentators, when they looked at this image of the sparrows, fairly uniformly looked at it and said, well, what Jesus is cautioning us against is don't sell yourself in the marketplace two for a penny. Stay safe in your Father's hands. Because we do have a longing for belonging. Families aren't everything now that they were once cracked up to be. This isn't, in this part of the country, that's not so much the case. But I do know people in California who pretty much thought that once you got out of the nest, well, you just abandon it. There is nothing left. The whole point is to spread your wings, to get out, to make your own place in the world. A family is just something for you to leave behind. It's not a place of belonging. And so they go to the marketplace to see who's playing pipes and who's wailing. And they see who they will sell themselves to for a penny so that they can find that belonging and that meaning. Rather than staying safe in the Father's hands, perhaps they don't even know them. And of course, we have learned that a lot of our problems, the things that we really struggle with, come from the mistakes that our parents made. And there's a temptation to get stuck there and not really learn the lesson that Jesus is trying to teach us, but rather to go to the finger pointing and the blaming. There's some people who don't want anything to do with their families, and they never quite get over it. But the interesting thing to me is that the family is the way that God chose for us to come into the world. They're not perfect, and sometimes they're broken, and some people never even meet either their father or their mother, but everyone has a father and a mother. And what's really amazing to me, and I have pointed it out before, is that we have overlooked that when it says that God created, it says humanity, really, it's a general word, in his image, male and female, he created them. In the image of God, he created them. The image is applied to them both together. And how is it that for so many centuries, a Trinitarian church that believed in the Father and the Son, an eternal love that was so powerful that it creates another person, eternally always present, eternally generated, like a family of three, that they don't see the image of God in the love of a husband and a wife that is not just for each other, but for the new life that is added more and more and more. And through that same Holy Spirit, we become a family of God. And this is what we're called again and again. Jesus is talking about the master of the household, the father of a great household and a great family. And so I think, and remember what John wrote in his letter, if you don't love your brother and sister whom you cannot, who you can see, do you really expect anyone to believe that you love your God whom you can't see? Likewise, if you don't love the family you can see, the one that you were given by God, remember, not even a sparrow falls apart from your father. Nothing happens apart from your father. If you can't love the family you can see, how will you ever be a part of the family that you cannot see? And for those who are fortunate enough to neither believe the lie that we're supposed to go out and join the marketplace and become cogs in the machine of civilization, eminently replaceable and eminently forgettable, even if we escape the trap of bitterness when we realize that our parents weren't perfect and a lot of our problems are multi-generational, and even then if we learn to love our families, Jesus is warning us, don't love them more than me. Because we're putting in our longing for belonging an impossible burden on them. They can't give us what we're looking for. In Genesis, after the tragedy with Cain and Abel, after Adam must feel like a terrible and colossal failure, it says when he was 130 years old, he became the father of a son in his own image and likeness and named him Seth. And it's the same words that were used in Genesis. And the question remains, was that likeness still the likeness of what it was supposed to be? What was he passing on to his son? He could only do his best. I think everyone, every member of a family at some point realizes that what we want to give to each other, we're just not up to the task. At some point when we grow up and we're seeing our parents eye to eye, we realize that there's something more that's needed, something much bigger. In that sense, if we're trying to answer that longing for belonging and we lean on our families, the dysfunction will remain. We're looking in the wrong place, and there we run into the trap of the two masters paradox. Jesus applied it in one specific instance to God and wealth. He said, you can't serve two masters. You're going to love one and hate the other, or be devoted to one, totally giving all your attention to it, and treat the other one with contempt, like something you could just scrape off the bottom of your shoe. So that if we forget to have God as our Father first, and we get wrapped back into that dysfunction of the family trying to find our fulfillment in itself, then we're going to suffer in that love. It's not going to make us happy. And by degrees, we will have either an active dislike for God and the church, who hasn't been wounded by a brother or sister in Christ, who doesn't have an example of something they can really hold on to, or we'll just be indifferent because we're so devoted to the other. And Jesus is cautioning us against it. We have a longing for belonging. If we want the family to be healed, we have to learn to see it again through our Father in heaven's eyes. And that's always going to be part of the cross. It won't get necessarily any easier. Strained relationships are always painful. But when we love God more, then we're no longer going to eat them up, and they're no longer going to eat us up. But still, isn't it a bit much and a bit shocking to hear the Prince of Peace use the image of a sword? I haven't come to bring peace, but a sword. It's a little shocking. When I was looking at the passage, I found nothing interesting that anyone was saying on it, but I went to the ancient Christian commentaries, and there was an anonymous commentary on the Gospel of Matthew. It was never finished. I think it was about from maybe the 3rd or the 4th century. And that commentator or that preacher noted, you know, there's a good peace and there's a bad peace. Not all peace is good. It's good when that peace is among faithful, good, and just people. Faith comes by hearing the word, and that faith is preserved in peace among the brothers and sisters of Christ. And it's nourished and nurtured to maturity by the love of God. As Paul said in Galatians, the only thing that matters is faith working through love. And in that peace, any conflict is bad. Any division, any sword coming in there is bad. As the Lord himself pointed out, no house divided against itself will stand. And if the faithful are divided, they'll consume themselves. As Paul said in that same epistle to the Galatians, if you're going to bite and devour each other, beware lest you consume each other. You could also understand that as just exploiting each other, trying to get what you need from each other and getting kind of rancorous and annoyed. You're just going to eat each other up. You're looking for what you can't find. So there's a good peace and a bad conflict. Likewise, there's a bad peace. There is an evil kind of peace among unbelievers and wicked people. You could say unhealthy, you can say dysfunctional if you're more comfortable with that word. But among them, there is a single culture of error and of dysfunction, and they're agreed on it. And even though this unbelief and this dysfunction is born through the influence of the enemy, it is also protected and sustained by peace, where everybody is agreed upon it. And for this reason, this ancient preacher wrote, God brought a good disunity to that evil peace in order to break it up. He noted that all people used to be together as if they lived in a single house of disbelief, the good and the evil together. And that's what we saw at Babel. That was the concern. They were trying to make a name for themselves. They weren't trying to do God's will or know who God was. They wanted to make a name for themselves. And so God broke up that evil unity, and likewise Jesus is bringing a sword of disunity among this evil or dysfunctional peace. And concerning this, Hebrews 4:12 says, "For the word of God is living and active and sharper than any double-edged sword, piercing even to the point of dividing soul from spirit and joints from marrow. It is able to judge the desires and the thoughts of the heart." That is the judgment of God for us, the Holy Spirit speaking to our hearts through the word to tell us what's wrong and what's right, to try to bring us to a point of healing, of truth, of true reconciliation with one another. And it's not described as a pleasant experience. Again, he's honest with us. It's not going to be easy. But if Jesus did it, we can do it. He was human, just like us. What did he have? The Holy Spirit? Do we not have that Spirit too? If he did it, we can do it. Most people, when they think of discipline and judgment, they think of something a little different. And it brings to mind kind of a funny one-liner that I remember growing up. I don't remember who originally delivered it. Sometimes it's put in the mouths of fathers, sometimes mothers, where they're angry with their children and they're warning them, "I brought you into this world, I can take you out." And it usually is a preamble to a good spanking. And in that sense, the world understands God's judgment because it does remain true. God gave us life. God can take it away. Some act as though that's wrong, as though God should abide by the Bill of Rights. We have a right to, or the Declaration of Independence. We have a right to life, liberty. That, okay, you can stay there. You can stay there if you want. But if you don't know God as Father, and you still have this notion of right and wrong, which we cannot get rid of. We can distort it. We can try to twist it to match what the kind of life we want to live, but we can't get rid of it. Then all we're going to feel outside of Christ, as the letter to Hebrews also says, once you get away from Christ, there's nothing left but sort of this dull sense of impending judgment. But within Christ, that same word, "I brought you into the world and I'll take you out of it," ceases to be an alleged threat, and in fact it becomes a beautiful promise. In Christ, we hear these words, "I sent you into this world and I will take you out of it to be with me where I am." And here's no place for a fancy argument or a lot of logic or a bunch of eloquence. There's nothing more eloquent than the cross of Christ standing empty against the sky. For him, he had no den or resting place to lay his head on this earth. It was just a launching pad. And the cross, in a way, if you want to continue the analogy, I think it's kind of lame, but here I go. The cross was his rocket to take him to the heavens, to where he truly belonged. And so he likewise commands us to follow also, to deny ourselves, deny all the voices in the marketplace. Don't sell yourself short. Stay safe and stay free in your Father's hands. Deny yourself and take up the cross and follow me. And we will be able to do it because he was able. We are sent into the world to find all of our brothers and sisters and to remind them who they are so that when the time comes, they will be ready to be taken home as well. And there's not just the one great homecoming when the new heavens and the new earth are created. It is a process during our life where we learn to trust and to love God, to slowly get away from that second fear to the final do not be afraid, when we realize we're in God's hands and there's nothing left to fear at all. Nothing left to doubt. As an example of what that looks like, there are several stories. But the one that I happened upon was the story of Martin Rinkert. He lived in Eilenburg, which is a city in East Germany. He was a pastor. It was during the 30 Years' War. This is one of the bloodiest wars that Europe saw in the early 1600s. Went on for 30 years. It initially started as a struggle between the Catholic and the Protestant countries. But it quickly devolved into just a war of all nations against all the others. With constantly shifting alliances, it revealed itself for what it was. A bunch of children in the marketplace fighting for power. Their lips might have been talking about God, but their hearts were very far from him. During this war, 8 million people, and this is back in the 1600s, 8 million people lost their lives. 20% of the population of Germany, where Martin Rinkert lived. The Swedes laid siege to that walled city. And a plague broke out. The people began to starve. And Martin Rinkert and the other pastors were performing a dozen funerals every day. And as time dragged on, the pastors started to go as well, until he alone was left, and he found himself doing 50 funerals a day. In a year, he did 5,000, including his wife's. When the war finally ended, he sat down and wrote these words: "Now thank we all our God with heart and hands and voices, who wondrous things has done, in whom this world rejoices, who from our mother's arms has blessed us on our way with countless gifts of love, and still is ours today." This was a man who had directly witnessed horrors and suffering beyond anything most of us could think or imagine. And yet he did not hesitate to lead the people of Eilenburg in praise and thanksgiving to the God and Father who, through the power at work within us, is able to do far more than we can ask or imagine. That's loyalty. The world may mock you for it. I know Erasmus mocked people for having hope and thankfulness in the midst of the suffering of the world. They will almost certainly mock us in their playing of flutes and their wailing, in their celebrations and their mournings. But the souls of the saints will sing on, for we're children of the Heavenly Father. We know what we have been sent to do, and we know where we're going. This is the assurance that we have been given by Jesus. He doesn't pull any punches, but he wants us to get over the fear, to learn to know God as our Father, and to begin to set everything right, both in our own relationships and in the world. And what come what may, we will always and forever sing his praises. As it says at the end of Amazing Grace, "Grace has taken me or led me safe thus far. Grace will lead me home. And when we've been there 10,000 years, we'll have no less days to sing God's praise than when we'd first begun." May God keep us all safe in the knowledge of his love for us, that through it our fears might be cast out, our hopes raised up anew, and we be given a renewed sense of purpose and life. For if no sparrow falls apart from our Father, then neither does one stay in the air. So as long as we're still in the air, let us soar and rise up on those eagle wings he's given us. Hope every day, new mercies every morning. What a glorious God and Father we have, through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The offering plates are on either side of the door. If you have an offering that you'd like to give and you didn't give it on the way in, you may give it certainly on the way out. Before our offertory, I invite you to share a word of prayer with me. Almighty and merciful God, you break the power of canceled sin and make all things new in the kingdom of your Son. Remembering Christ, who bore our sins and bought us peace with you, we offer these gifts willingly with gratitude and praise. Help us die to the world and live for you. It is a reasonable and fitting response to Christ's offering for us and his call to discipleship. Please, Father, prepare us for any sacrifice that might be asked of us, of all who seek to live in faithful response to the way, the truth, and the life of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Our hymn of dedication is Heralds of Christ. We'll sing the first two verses before the benediction and the third verse after. All praise and thanks to God the Father now be given, the Son and Him who reigns with them in highest heaven, the one eternal God, whom earth and heaven adore. For thus it was, is now, and shall be evermore. Now to Him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can ask or imagine, to Him be glory in the Church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Lord, give us faith and strength the road to build, to see the promise of the day fulfilled. When war shall be no more, and strife shall cease. Upon